The growing demand for cannabis in our country. I mean, Stats Canada just released a report 3 weeks ago that confirmed what we already all know, is that 47% of the Canadian population has admitted to using cannabis at some time in their life. 37% is an occasional toker, which would be within the last year. And 13% is what we describe as chronic. Now, how are we supposed to deal with this growing problem if we don't have a regulated system in place?
Well, that's up to the government to decide. I know they're talking about decriminalization, but they're not talking about legalization. They're talking about a different form so people don't have criminal records that use cannabis. Now, as far as the law goes, the possession of marijuana is still a criminal offense, and we have a duty to enforce that law, and we will.
Ryan, let me ask you a question about your cafe. Where do people get the marijuana?
It's a tolerance bar.
Where do they get the marijuana?
Well, their source is up to them. You know,
You don't have any there?
We don't have any on site. We're not distributing it.
What about paraphernalia? Papers, bongs, pipes, stuff like that.
That is available, but just getting back to the
I want to go back to the question. I want to get an idea what people could expect if they went into your place. And as you said before, they sign a waiver, which means they're basically saying, look, if I get busted or something happens, you guys aren't responsible, right?
Exactly, that's correct.
But you are providing, you know, you are providing some of the necessities that are needed to smoke marijuana, right?
Absolutely, and in regards to distributing marijuana, as of October, there's new legislation that's being pushed through Parliament as we speak to reintroduce the decriminalization bill. So basically, we're calling Paul Martin's bluff on this one because we want to make sure that he actually follows through with his promises. And we will be able to distribute marijuana to card-carrying MMAR members, which is the Medicinal Marijuana Access Regulatory Policy.
But Ryan, this is it's a minority government situation, and that changes the dynamics of this law. If they don't push for it soon, you could be stuck with a shop that really won't be able to be open. What are you going to do?
Well, there's also to consider David Christofferson, which is the NDP candidate that is a municipal member of parliament for our Hamilton downtown central location. My partner in this business, Chris Goodwin, is a political science student at McMaster University. And we're up for the challenge of ensuring that our business is operated safely and properly.
You're not answering the question, though. The business.
What's going to happen to your business?
Essentially, the business is illegal.
Up
you're running
smoke,
it.
Up in smoke, I suppose. It's just going to go up in smoke. You know, if the police want to enforce the law, they will. But let's face it. Like, this problem isn't going to go away, and no amount of bastardization and discrimination on this topic is ever going to make us hang up our bongs and our paraphernalia, as so it's called by the criminal code.
That's all well and good. Membership prices. If you want to become a member of this club, I mean, are you guys making some pretty good money off of this deal?
The membership base is a not-for-profit organization called the Hamilton Compassion Society. Mm-hmm. There's also one in Toronto called the TCC, the Toronto Compassion Center. And again, this is all not-for-profit. This goes towards NORML. This is the National Organization for
Reform of Marijuana Law.
Also legal aid.
Ryan, did they put up the money for you to open, or did you have to get a bank loan?
No, you know, this is a private investment for my own portfolio. I believe my partner did secure a bank loan, so there's obviously some support there.
I have a question for Ryan.
Ryan, are you making a profit at this place, or you're making a profit from criminal activity?
Oh, no, that's a loaded question, dude. You know, I'm sorry. You know, it's going to be a business. We want to run it as a business. You know, I have a certain standard of living that I want to accomplish. But, you know, I want to do something socially responsible. And this seems like it's a cause that is long overdue for some sort of policy.
Are employees allowed to be stoned?
Employees, well, we do have sessions, you know, we're going to have workshops down there, and it's not just all about smoking the Chiba, you know, we have hemp goods, and we have, you know, clothing and art gallery. We're also setting up pottv.net, which is going to be a news studio that is going to be, broadcasting all the relevant topics to the marijuana community.
All right, well, I'm sure we haven't heard the end of this one, and I want to thank our guests today, Ryan Clark and Deputy Chief Ken Leendernst, and I'll bet you we'll have more stories about this issue as time goes on. Gentlemen, thank you.
No doubt.
Thank you.
Tonight on CH News.
Happy 420. Have a joy.
Free marijuana handouts at a Hamilton cafe. From the Hamilton, Holton, and Niagara News Center, this is CH News at 6.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dan McLean. Well, you've likely heard of Weedless Wednesday, but today marks a little-known occasion that actually celebrates sparking up, known by those who practice the cannabis culture as 420. April 20th is something of a holiday for marijuana users. And CHS Natalie Marconi found out a local pot spot was giving weed away for free.
It's against the law to sell marijuana and also to possess it. But today it's being given away for free at the Up and Smoke Cafe.
What's up, buddy?
Happy 420. Have a joint, brother.
Thank you very much.
Do you like a bong hit as well?
Might as well, sure.
What is 420? Some say it's the universally recognized time of day to light up. Others believe it's the number of active chemicals in marijuana. However this holiday started, it's viewed by pot smokers as their day to indulge.
I announced yesterday, actually during an arrest yesterday, that I'd give away an ounce of weed today, and I'm going to live up to my promise, and it's all going to be free. I'm just going to keep handing them out all day long, slowly, and keep letting my customers enjoy the freedoms that we have here.
But two customers were stripped of their freedoms briefly on Tuesday evening by local police officers. This woman witnessed one of the arrests, but it didn't stop her from coming back.
And it was an old guy, and they handcuffed him for no reason. They took his money as evidence, he took whatever had on him as evidence, and then dragged him out, and he was back here a half an hour later.
My faithful friend John, happy 420, brother.
Thank you.
Despite frequent police visits, Goodwin says he entertains as many as 250 customers a day.
Not everybody's a regular that likes to just sit down. Other people just come in to buy scales or papers or seeds or pipes or... And I get a lot of walk-bys. Of course, I think the city says 14,000 people go by here a day. So that's huge.
A budding business that will likely be busted again. Natalie Marconi, CH News, Hamilton.
From the Hamilton, Holton, and Niagara News Center, this is CH News at 6.
An anniversary celebration of the city's first marijuana cafe in downtown Hamilton today. Supporters gathered for the event on King Street East under the watchful eyes of police. CH's Lisa Knapp reports there was an uneasy truce between officers and the couple hundred people who came out.
Celebrating the right to do this is what this was all about. Supporters of Hamilton's Up and Smoke Cafe gathered across the street from where the business is located on King East. Several cars seemed to honk approval. No surprise to Michael Baldessaro, a longtime marijuana supporter.
You know, people that have jobs, careers, professionals, they'd be here, but they're in the cars going by blowing the horn. But if they made themselves known, they'd be fired. That's the problem.
But cafe owner Chris Goodwin says this is more than a celebration. It's a message to police and politicians.
The public health concern and not a criminal matters concern. So taking out law enforcement and the justice system away from marijuana smokers is a more effective policy.
But not everyone enjoyed the event, like this downtown resident who's lived here for 19 years.
This is not fair to the people downtown. The place, no wonder people don't want to come down here.
Yeah. Not a waste of time.
No, it's terrible. Go somewhere else.
Supporters ended with a gathering at City Hall. For the sake of safety, police refrained from wading into the crowd to lay charges for now.
And we will be laying charges in future, whether it be under the city bylaw or trafficking in cannabis. That's for us to determine a date and time when that will be done. But for the time being, I don't want any large altercations down here, and I'm just going to escort them along to City Hall and back.
Okay. The gathering wrapped up by 4:30. Police reported only one.
Tonight on CH News.
A controversial cafe opens for business in downtown Hamilton.
From the Hamilton, Holton, and Niagara News Center, this is CH News at 6.
Good evening, everyone. A controversial grand opening in Hamilton today has created quite a buzz. The Up and Smoke Cafe has opened its doors, and it caters to a certain clientele, people who smoke marijuana. As CH's Cindy Chordash tells us, there's a cloud of confusion as to the legal issues surrounding the establishment and their rules.
Steel City Bud is on its way, let me tell you.
Owners of the Up and Smoke Cafe are confident their store will be accepted in Hamilton.
The laws are in a state of flux right now. It's tolerated under certain conditions. That's why we're currently operating as a private social club.
A club that allows members to smoke pot inside the cafe. The store sells pot-related products, coffee and pop, and soon will open a kitchen to serve some baked goods.
Some reports have said that the Up and Smoke Cafe will sell cannabis goodies such as hash brownies or pot cookies to medicinal users. Owners say that no marijuana will be sold over the counter. Customers have to bring their own pot.
Hamilton police say the Pot Cafe is a first for the city, and although they've established a good relationship with the owners, the department still has to uphold the law.
This is the first day it's just open. We'll have to kind of see what happens. But no, you can't just sit there and smoke marijuana because it is an offense under the code.
Against the law or not, that's not stopping patrons at the cafe.
I think it means that Hamilton is becoming a mature city. We're catching up with the likes of Montreal, Toronto, and Vancouver, and other places in Canada that have had the insight to allow people to have the freedom and joy and pleasure of enjoying a little marijuana.
Not everyone sees it that way.
This promotes crime in downtown Hamilton. It's having enough trouble to get people to come here, and then you get a pot cafe. Bad down here again.
Pot smokers say they hope the opening of the cafe will put decriminalizing weed high on the federal government's list. Cindy Chordash, CH News, Hamilton.
The opening of the Up and Smoke Cafe coincides with Cannabis Day. And to celebrate the occasion, a small group marched down Main Street to show support for the legalization of marijuana. Police were on hand to escort the crowd, but they wouldn't say if any charges would be laid. The owners of the cafe described the march as one of non-violent civil disobedience.
Hey, I'm not a terrorist or a cocaine smuggler. I don't live in a grow house, have a lot of guns, or own a black excursion. And I've never sold pot to Jimmy, Sally, or Susie from Montana. Although I'm certain they would have paid in U.S. dollars. I had a prime minister, not a president, except he didn't speak English or French or any known language. But he did say he was going to smoke pot. At least I think that's what he said. And I can proudly share my country's homegrown. I believe in lighting up, not locking up. Bubble hash, not swag. That BC Bud is truly the best pot in the world. And John Walters is the crack of politicians. Marijuana is a herb. And George W. Bush is the dope. Cannabis is our number one industry. The United States is our number one customer. And we are exporting across North America. My name is none of your business, because I am Canadian.
Vapor Central, are you ready for an entertainment experience only slightly more entertaining than a Magic Bullet infomercial marathon? I hope so, because it's time for the CK Podcast. And here's your host, Cal Post.
Hey, Vapor Central, how the fuck are you? Let's all clap at once. Thank you for coming out. Oh, this is huge. You are watching the CK Podcast. I am one half of the host. I'm Cal Post. K-Trev can't be here because he's working. He's touring across the country doing jokey jokes. Oh, I hope you're doing good. It is hot outside, but it is cold up here. Motherfucker in the corner's wearing a sweater. That's how you do it here at Vapor Central. You high? Is everybody high? Wow, what excitement with the weed. We have a great show tonight. We have a fantastic show. But before we even get to my guest, first off, if you've been watching the show in the last couple of weeks, I've been furious. Just angry at these new Coca-Cola commercials. Have you seen these Coca-Cola commercials where they show the security cameras? Have you seen them? They're fucking freaky. Coke is selling a commercial where it's like, we've been watching you, and here's a bunch of nice shit, but we're still watching you. And so they just released this new commercial, and I was disgusted. I was like, Coke, you've gone too far, Coke. This is too much. Anyway, if you can play the video, this is the new Coca-Cola commercial that just came out. Just twisted. Wait, watch this. I can't believe this. Fuck. How fucked up is that commercial? Do I agree? Isn't that like Coca-Cola? Just back the fuck up. That's been my favorite viral video for the last 2 weeks. Hey, Chris, can we just play the straight-up video of the... If you haven't seen this video, it's my new favorite video. It's a wonderful woman in downtown Toronto in the Club District. And she's just having a great time hanging out in front of the club when this happens. You don't know if you got it, Chris? It looks like she's going to scratch herself. She reaches up under her skirt. You're like, oh, look at her just going in there, just scratching. Just going crazy. And then she shits in her hand and throws it in the alleyway. Watch, it's coming up here. Look at this. Look, just digging. There she goes. Oh! Oh, you'll never look at girls in short skirts the same way again. I'm sorry, guys in the crowd. I'm sorry. How fucked is that? Makes me laugh, though, every single goddamn time. Thank you once again for coming by. If you're at home watching this, you're probably sweating in your little shitty apartment. You should be down here where there's air conditioning. You enjoying the air conditioning here at Vapor Central? Yeah, you are. This is the best place. Smoke weed and be cold. I love it. Your guest this week, everybody. This is awesome. I've been wanting to do this for a while. Chris Goodwin in the back, my producer, and he runs this establishment. Big round of applause for Chris. An amazing man, a protester, and he's done so much for the weed movement, and I'm going to talk for an hour and a half about his history and where this weed culture is going. Please welcome Chris Goodwin, everyone. Big round of applause. Controlling everything from the BlackBerry. Hi, Chris.
Hey. I got the chat.
Oh, you got the chat?
They always want you to see it.
Oh, yeah, this is great.
I just pull it up on my BlackBerry.
What do we got
playbook
here? The true OG. I didn't color up, but it's straight.
I'm never up here.
Somebody write something. If you're watching this, write something fucked up so I can say it out loud.
They will, too.
I do. I want to see something. But that is fucked. Oh, they just watched the girl shit. That's... Somebody.
There's only a slight delay, maybe a couple seconds.
Okay,
but
I'll just leave it right here for now. Chris, thank you for doing the whole show with me tonight.
Yeah.
Where to start?
I don't know. I was curious what you were going to do with me as a guest. You've been asking me for a couple weeks to come up here and talk to you.
This is the first time I've had someone sit down and I've got to interview them, like properly interview them about their history. I'm gonna fucking king
well,
the I'm shit out of this.
I'm not saying nothing unless you ask the question.
All right, so here, okay, let's start with, because we know you run this place and you're a huge advocate with weed and everything, but it goes beyond that, obviously. How old were you when you were first, this is fucked? The government is fucked.
I was like 14, 15.
I was really hoping you were going to say four. Just four, smoking a joint. This is fucked.
Well, it could go back that far, but just not with weed. I was probably like 4 or 5 years old. And in my parents' house, we had like a fruit cellar under the porch where everything was cold. You kept jams.
Right.
And on like a December 10th or a 15th or something like that, I got in there. And half the presents in there said from Santa, and that my mind was blown.
I was like, four when that happened?
I was about 4 or 5 years old.
Your world got crushed.
It was. I knew something was up, and I believed I was on to something.
Santa's not real. I'm fucked. What's happening to this world?
Yeah.
Oh, I will take this time just to say Happy Pride Week, everybody. Happy Pride Week. This is what makes this country so great. This is why Canada's awesome.
We do like a super soaker thing here. Everybody has pails of water and we spray and have hoses.
That's fucking awesome.
On Saturday, I believe, if you're down here. Sunday? Sunday.
Oh, that's perfect. After the parade?
So the big march. And while it's going on, we're soaking them with water. Cops and everything. You just can't hit a drag queen. Anybody who's in full makeup.
Is there no fear, like, when you go to reach for your super soaker?
My son loves it. Every year he's been doing it.
Why aren't you afraid of, like, a cop? Like,
one cop got mad. He was like, stay away from the face, not the face.
Yeah.
Yeah, he doesn't even want his mascara to run. That's what that was. He stay away from the face. What does he think you're spraying? Ah, fucking cops. All right, so, what was your first big movement into this culture.
A friend of mine handed me the book, Jack Harrer, The Emperor Wears No Clothes. And if anybody's seen the movie Grass, narrated by Woody Harrelson, this is the book that movie inspired, it was inspired from. It's basically the U.S. war on drugs. Henry Anslinger, the paper industry, and all that kind of stuff. There's a Family Guy episode and a bunch of others that say that same U.S. war on drugs scenario. And I read that, and I had one of those epiphany moments. I went, oh, my God, I've been lied to.
And you've been smoking weed at this point.
Yes, maybe 2 years before that.
So how old were you when you first picked up a joint? That first joint. What was? Tell me the story of the first time you got high. I love this.
I have an older brother, so I was like 12 or 13 or something like that, and I remember him giving me cigarettes or me wanting to have a drag off a cigarette. So he's like 16 years old and I'm 12, and he gives me a drag of a smoke and I cough. And then I remember being at a party with all 16 and 17-year-olds, and they were putting a cigarette into a bottle, into a beer bottle. After also giving me one a sip of beer, too. Never giving me a full 12 beer.
12 years old.
Yeah. And the cigarette in the bottle was obviously doing hash pots. And I didn't know that at the time. I thought it was a different way to inhale the cigarette from the tip or something. I was confused. But that's what I remember thinking as the moments had happened.
Right.
Obviously, I learned more. We're inquisitive. We immediately start asking questions to get the answers to them, right? And start getting better at things.
So did you get high right away?
Oh, I was very high off that.
So always, a lot of people have that story. It's like, I didn't even get high the first time, man. And I've heard that a lot. I remember the first time I got high, and I was fucked.
Yeah?
Just ruined. But it was like, we didn't know what we were doing. We had a big fucking joint. We smoked all of it all at once.
What do you mean a big joint?
Well, buddy just bought a bunch of pot, had no idea what to do with it.
But you went like big joint.
Oh, no, sorry, it's probably like that.
Okay.
About the size of my cock. Anyway. Yeah, but we just smoked way too much because we had no idea.
Because one time a few years after I started smoking, we found a pot plant in like late September, half budded, not even finished. We ripped it off, obviously. Dried the whole thing out in the oven and then overnight, and friends were all like, who owned this? We were all going to smoke it together, like the four of us that found it. And yeah, we rolled joints that were 2 feet long and like the size of your arm. But it was crap. We were mixing in everything, all the leaf and everything at the time.
Yeah, I can't smoke it now because I've got too many fucked up addictions. Not fucked up. I booze and I smoke cigarettes and then I jerk off way too much. It's like I just can't get weed into that. That's already too much on my plate in terms of addictions.
Alcohol and tobacco.
It's the worst ones. The worst ones that I love. So I just, I don't know.
Everything in moderation. I don't know. Except
for
weed.
Yeah, that's a hard one.
I smoke a lot of.
Okay, well, here's a good question, because you've smoked weed now for many, many years. Is it addictive? Is it actually addictive?
Well, there's no chemical dependence, if what you're referring to as addiction.
Right.
Like, when you remove the substance, there is no, like, chemical withdrawal. It's not like you might miss it.
Right.
You know, you might build up, you know, something that's habitual. So it might be habit forming.
Okay.
But it's like any other habit. You just enjoy doing things either daily or weekly or, you know, ceremoniously, ritually. There are different reasons why different people do the same thing over and over again because they enjoy it, but they enjoy it for different reasons. And there's nothing wrong with that, I don't think. And no, that's not addiction.
Right.
So
how much weed do you smoke per day?
Oh, I smoke a lot of weed.
Someone left these at the front.
The wife and I split most of the weed we smoke, so I don't know. I just smoke what I feel comfortable smoking, so I'll just light up a joint when I wake up and bong hits when I wake up and then all day long until I go to bed and then...
I just want to see if anyone can beat you how much you do a day.
It probably average personally, I don't know, 4 to 5 grams a day.
That's not too bad.
Yeah.
Who can beat 4 to 5 grams a day? Who's got that beat?
4 to 5, yeah.
I got one guy.
I'm sure lots of people smoke more than 4 or 5 grams a day. Like, some people smoke 10 grams,
I wanted
half
to ask
ounce.
You, because we were watching the news clips.
But every day, I smoke that much weed every day.
Can we count concentrates in that? Because I think I'd beat you if we count dabs.
Concentrates, that's interesting. But.
How come every time I see these news, like you were playing a bunch of news clips,
I hate
what the news does, because everyone they interviewed, aside from the people who own the establishments, like yourself, they always show the most cracked out looking people. Well, there's always people like just bags under her eyes, sitting in a chair. It's like, I just like it. Like, what do they show? I see guys here all the time in like suits. Like, it takes all kinds, and they never seem to interview. They always look for the person.
Well, are you talking about the people that were criticizing us? There were two people in those clips that were saying, this place sucks, it's bad for the downtown.
No, when
and
they were
I knew both of those people, and they were on my payroll, basically. It was all set up that way. At least from my end, and I can't believe it kept working newscast after newscast. I learned early on that newscasters are vultures. They'll do whatever they can for a story, for both sides. And I think it made a hell of a lot more sense than, for instance, having a guy in a suit give an accurate description of why the drug war should continue. Or why, because it's illegal, we should be arrested, and give that in an articulated fashion. We would lose community support if that happened. You know, if it's some city councilor type, some lawyer type, is just like, you know, what they're doing is breaking the law, and then the statute says, and this would cause civil unrest. If he made an articulated thing like that, we would have been in trouble. But if there's some old 68-year-old hag who goes, you know, this place is going to be all dry, and she's just, nobody believes the hag. Like,
well, they're hags.
Yeah, when we were on the 6 o'clock news,
they're dirty, awful, stinky hags.
It was stoner, it was hippie, it was... You know, there was a whole bunch of people in my cafe, my age, younger, and then the old people, and they were stoners and hippies, and we were doing the best we could to give the best argument we could to end prohibition,
right,
and to open up these pot cafes and to do smokeouts. And then our opposition, we were trying to have controlled opposition with that, in a way. It didn't always work. They interviewed other people, too, and stuff. But for the most part, they kept using our bait. At the time, we actually had a lot of different things that we were trying to do as ways to get the most exposure.
You smarmy motherfucker.
Well, see, the thing is going on, when I was given that book, The Emperor Wears No Clothes, when I was 16, 15, I immediately started doing every school project on the drug war from in every angle possible. And then I started to do it more publicly. I tried to get... Like, I did a thing called the Hemp Awareness Seminar that only, like, 30 people showed up to. And then I did an outdoor, like, hemp-type festival, more of, like, a literature day where we tried to print up as much. And me and other friends of mine at the time were all trying to do this fun thing to promote. In a way, it was like the green movement today, even though I didn't believe in anything those type of people say. But what we started to find out is that we weren't very successful, that... Most of the people believed what we were saying. We were only giving a very mild argument at best about we should grow more hemp and biomass. And
right.
And everyone was like, sure, grow more hemp. You know, sure, biomass. So there was no argument. There was nothing. So I started researching in the early days of the internet. It was like the Usernet and there was forums. And so I started typing online my experiences and getting advice. And guys like Mark Emery and David Malmalevine and some of those clips that I played highlight, you know, they started contacting me and saying, listen, stop doing what you're doing and start doing civil disobedience. And that changed my life as well. Instead of just, for the last 4 or 5 years, up until the point where Mark Emery contacted me, and then David Malmalevine and I started talking in emails and stuff, I had thought, you know, if you just give a good... articulated argument, everything will be fine.
Right.
And
do you feel like, because one of the documentary was comparing like gay marriage, the rise to legalization from the points of view of gay marriage and weed. Do you ever feel like weed's one of those things, the reason why it's taking so long is because no one really gives a fuck in general? Like your average person is okay with it, but doesn't go out of their way to help. You have two extremes on either side of the issue, so you're fighting the extreme... I get a right-wing aspect of it, people who are very much against it, and then people who are very much for it fighting it, but all these people in between who are generally just like, meh, whatever, they'll figure it out. I got to go to work.
Well, we hear that all the time. We're trying to make the impassioned argument that you know, they're arresting 100,000 Canadians a year for drugs, right? That they've never arrested that amount of people in any other disenfranchised class, so... although there were laws against gays in some aspects, it wasn't like they were arresting 100,000 people a year. Yeah, we didn't afford them, equality, and that was an injustice in itself. But Yeah, it's tough. I hear that all the time. There's more important things, right?
Right.
Than the drug war. So no matter how many arguments I make, people will still say, there's more important things. And from the argument of, we agree with you 9/10 of the way, right? I'm there. I'm with you.
But it doesn't even seem like the law hammers down on weed either. Like, I've known, like, my parents and most of my friends' parents growing up smoked weed freely, and no one really seemed to bother them. Like, it wasn't... The police aren't enforcing it to such a degree like anything else. They're kind of laid back with it.
Well, I disagree. Like, now had that article recently about, since 2001, the increase is 50% of the arrests in Toronto. They were arresting 3,500 people a year in 2000-2001 era. They're arresting 7,000 to 9,000 people a year today.
Jesus. While our mayor sits back and smokes crack.
Yeah.
Get those potheads.
On and on. The drug war is going to get worse every day. And next year it's going to be even worse until the day in which we repeal prohibition. And that's what I'm fighting for. I just want the law gone.
Right.
And it's an unjust law.
It's loud in here tonight, eh?
Yeah, well.
All right, so you smoke weed, you love it. You read The Emperor, you love it. Next logical step, up and smoke.
Well, people started telling me, like, that wasn't the next step. The next step was smokeouts. I couldn't just open a business right away. I was working part-time jobs, and I was...
What was your part-time job?
Oh, I've worked 50 jobs in my life. A lot of construction. So I did waterproofing, framing, roofing, a lot of that kind of thing. But I drove a truck for 7 years of my life.
Right.
Yeah, it wasn't until I was like 23, 24 that I actually opened my own pot cafe. But when I was 18, I did my first 420 smokeout. Instead of doing these hemp seminars and other trying to get on the radio, and they never really cared. I'd write letters to the editor and get published twice a year.
How did you care this much at 18?
Friends,
when I was 18, all that mattered was my dick was wet. That's all I fucking wanted. That's all I did. It's like, I got to bang chicks somehow.
Well.
That was my whole...
I was getting laid a lot, so that was easy.
You motherfucker.
It wasn't the hard thing. That was easy. But I don't know. What seemed hard to me was what people were saying we can't do. You can't smoke pot openly. We're doing this all in secret. You got to hide. And that always intrigued me. People saying to me, you can't do this openly. And then, you know... overlapped with guys like Mark Emery saying, openly smoke weed and whatever. I was also getting that influence. So I did my first 420 smokeout, and we're talking news trucks.
Okay, so explain a smokeout.
So
how do you establish them? At what time? How do you get people there?
Well, all my posters before that, Mark Emery used to call them loud because I put a lot of information, almost the way I talk. I just rant.
Right.
So he would say, make it concise. You know, April 20th, pot leaf, half the poster, 2 p.m.
Weed, man.
Weed, you know, and then, but you put your name, you put your, you know, you basically, it's civil disobedience. You take responsibility for your open illegality, right? You're going to openly disobey the law. So you got to take responsibility for that and be willing to
accept
that.
Do you call the cops ahead of time and let them know, like, look, I'm doing this?
You send them a friendly fax, yes.
Oh, a fax back in the day?
That starts out... Yeah, back in the day it was faxes, and I had to go down to Shoppers Drug Mart to fax them. And then from advice that I got would say something to the effect of, I am planning to invoke my Section 7 right to assemble with others, and my Section 2 right to this, and my Section 5 right to that. And I'm just invoking it. I'm not asking your permission. I'm telling you I'm doing it, and prepare yourself. And normally the course of action is you do that about the night before.
Is there a section in there where I can jerk off in public?
I don't know about that.
And I send the cops a fax like, look, dude.
But if you wanted to do that, I'm sure I would argue the best course of action you would do it openly and honestly. And if you're wrong at the end of the day, even in the worst scenario, at least you did it
openly. Hi, police. I'd like to use a section I made up. I will be masturbating in public at the corner of fucking Sherburn and Dundas where I'm going to do it. I'm not going to get caught at Sherburn and Dundas. All the fuck up shit that happens there. Anyway, back to weed.
So I did my open smokeout, and instead of like a dozen people, and they all really didn't care, and all now 100 people showed up, and news trucks and police cars, and everyone was confused, and this was a political, you know, it was exciting to me.
What happened to that thick, black, luxurious hair you had back when you were a kid? Jesus. But it was so fucking thick on you. You look like a Lego man.
I cut it that morning, stupidly, in that one clip.
I'm going to be on TV, so I'm going to cut my own hair.
Trim my bangs. That was a dumb move.
Is there any TV stuff you're ashamed that, you, like, when you look back on it, like, fuck,
I'm ashamed in everything.
Why? Look what you did. Look at this fucking place. Don't be ashamed.
I'm nervous before every interview I've ever done, and especially if it's news media. Not here.
No, not me. I'm dumb.
You're silly.
I like it. You're smart, but I'm loud, so we'll leave it out somewhere in the middle.
No, but I don't usually watch my own stuff. I only do so to see how I could better do it. I don't know.
Right.
I'm not an entertainer. You guys are performers. I don't know how you guys do it in that way.
Booze,
yeah.
That's one of the things, one of the reasons I never got into the pod either, because it would stop me from performing.
Yeah.
Especially when I started performing here. Oh, if you're watching, we do comedy shows all goddamn week here. So come out to those too. Weedy Wednesdays, Third Class Thursdays, Stoner Sundays. Awesome fucking shows. But I used to come here and get high, and then I go on stage, and I couldn't remember shit. Like, not one thing. I have to go word by word. The guy said. But anyway. So what happened? How did Up in Smoke start? That's your first vapor lounge.
2 or 3 years. Like, we're talking 99 was the first year I did a smoke out. And then 2000 was even bigger. We're talking almost close to 1,000 people showed up. And then 2001, 2002, we were getting over 1,000 people at every smoke out we were doing. And then I started hearing about other smoke outs. The Niagara Falls crew that was working with people over in Rochester and Niagara Falls, New York as well, in Buffalo. And then there was people in Toronto that were starting stuff. First of all, they had been doing things for 10 years already. So now you're talking, you know, 2002, 2003, and these people had been doing stuff since 92, 93. And so I started getting inundated with that kind of the marijuana movement as it existed at the time. And I tried to open my first pot cafe. And in early 2003, I opened a little place on Hamilton Mountain, and it got raided the first week.
In Hammertown.
In Hamilton,
one of the grossest places on earth.
So a couple days into opening it, SWAT team raid. Full on. SWAT team.
Fucking cool.
Shotguns, baklavas, police cars.
Oh, did they just like slam into you, throw you to the ground?
Oh, yeah.
Fucking cool.
It was kind of cool.
I'd get such a boner if that happened to me.
See, I start also learning that a lot of people that said it was cool doing all this, like, everyone thinks it's cool to be here, but then once
I'd be a huge pussy, man. I would have cried.
Even if you cried during, there's some people that cry during that are still heroes to me, because then they persist for 10 more years and do some amazing activism. And there are others that probably didn't cry during necessarily, but and then come out after and say, you know, I can't take this.
I would have cried, shit myself a bit.
Yeah.
Such a goddamn pussy. So what did you do? You got tackled.
So, well, you know, I spent the next, God, I spent, you know, 3.5 weeks in jail until
you
I got
raped?
Out.
Did you get raped?
No.
Were you raped? Come on.
I spent 11 and a half months of my life in jail for marijuana. All for marijuana. Every time I've ever been arrested, and I've been arrested 13 times in 12 years.
And not one rape.
Not one rape, no.
Who'd you rape?
I've never
raped. I know jail rules. If you don't get raped, it's because you're doing the raping.
Real jail rules. But no raping.
What was jail like?
Jail's crazy.
I'm assuming a minimum, security or max?
Well, what do you mean? Minimum or max?
That's, were you in there with Paul like Bernardo?
Like, no.
Boo.
Well, I guess you could have been it sometimes. Not him specifically, but I've heard of things like that. Where, like, Barton Jail in Hamilton has, like, 6 floors, and they're all each wing, and then they're separated left and right, and this and that. And then all of a sudden, one whole wing, all the inmates get moved off of that wing. It gets shut down, and then there's security 24 hours, and then we hear in the news that, yeah, like terrorists have been arrested or something, and
that's fucked up.
And they got to keep them completely separate from everybody else in jail.
So they have levels to it.
But are the levels per crime, like whatever crime you did, puts you at a certain level?
Sometimes, yeah.
So if you go into like, ah, fuck, I'm going into level like three, level I should have just murdered somebody so I could get the penthouse.
Yeah, it does work like that sometimes.
That's fucking weird.
And there's people that want to go into segregation, so, and or if you're gonna, if you think you're going to be hurt, you go in and say, I can't go into regular ranges, you know, I'm going to get hurt, and they put you into segregation.
Right. So when you were in jail, how'd you get along with the guys?
Well, that's the thing, like, first of all, I grew up with half criminals around me. First of all, smoking and growing weed and selling weed and stuff. But then, see, actually, that was the thing that bugged me about growing up, which was that as a child, I started seeing it like 10, 11, 12, that there were things in life that would probably should be illegal. When we hurt other people, when we steal from them, you know, there are times where people should intervene or defend themselves or do other things, and that made sense, but just being gay or being smoking a plant or some things didn't make sense to me. Why is it that when you don't hurt anybody else or their property, when you're doing something completely peaceful that people would intervene with force? It always didn't make sense.
Well, I noticed that with Mark Emery when they were following his trail of where he sold seeds.
Yeah.
It's like, how did they figure that out? They'd have to go to those places like everywhere he sold seeds, the place just blew up with the fun.
Yeah.
That's what we noticed. Everywhere there were seeds, it was just everyone having a good time. This has to stop. It's just so ridiculous, because they didn't lead to any murders or anything like that.
There's a weird contradiction in my life, which is that half the people I grew up with were also criminals. They stole cars or whatever. They also wanted to fight people on a game. They got arrested for assaults or whatever. They also were bad people in general in other ways. I had stupid friends and good friends, too. But in jail, a lot of people are criminals, although there are people in there for nonviolent, peaceful crimes, right?
Right.
A lot of people are in there for violent crimes. But I was still like a pot star in there. I was on the 6 o'clock news the night before.
Oh, so you came into jail like with applause.
There's an applause, and even by criminals. So it was a weird thing for me because even in my life, up to about the time I started getting arrested continuously,
right.
A lot of the criminal friends I had or people that were also doing other crimes would disassociate themselves with me. I was advocating their arrest.
Oh, that's awesome. That's some Godfather shit.
I know. So it's
you walk it in to kiss your ring. Did you get? Well, you got to get a big ring now and just kiss it. Kiss it.
But I was going on, CH News and Hamilton Spectator articles and advocating for the repeal of prohibition because it's unjust, but that we should focus on violent crimes and stuff,
right.
And true criminal activity and true assault and thefts and murders, rapes, whatever, and none of my friends are murderers or rapists, but you know what I mean. Like, it just, they didn't, all my friends were fuck the police. All my friends were Thug Life West Side. All my friends were, you know, listening to Method Man or they were listening to Nine Inch Nails. Or, you know, it didn't matter if they were rap or rock or whatever. Most people were anti-government, anti-society.
So was this around the time that you learned about, trying to think of the right word. Activism that's not violent in nature? Like a more peaceful way of protesting?
Yeah.
You told me that when you were younger, you were a lot more feral about the whole thing. Like you were angry. There were parts that you just wanted to...
I'm still very angry about it.
No. But how you deal with, say, police if they've ever walked in... Like I've heard stories of you doing it, and you're very calm, collected.
I've had to train myself to be that way. Naturally, I'm an instigator. I poke the bear. I've been like 13 arrests. I've actually had over 250 police encounters in my life, and I could have been arrested at least 240 of them. You know, there's less than 10 that they couldn't have arrested me at the time for something, and half of those, like over 100 times, I was instigating them to arrest me more. Or to arrest me just in general.
I dare you. I double dare you.
There was a double
dare. I double dare you, asshole.
Yeah.
any cop tune you up real good?
Oh, yeah. In the 13 times I've been arrested, like, half of them at least have been violently physical.
Right? Like kicking you in the balls type shit?
Not in the balls or anything like
no.
that. No.
If I was a cop, I'd kick everyone in the balls. That'd be my... That's what I do all the time. But you're under arrest.
Every movement is, yeah, when they put you on the ground and the knee to the neck, you're choking. You can't breathe. Your face is against concrete. You get up and there's scrapes on you, and that's from the force they apply. The cuffs are on too tight.
But can't they only do that if you
give
them reason, right?
Sure, I gave them full-out reason to do it.
Couldn't you just put your hands out and go do it?
I could have, but you go limp sometimes. You become a problem for them because the cameras are rolling. And there's no point in me passively condoning their oppression. I'd rather them have to drag me.
Kicking and screaming, yeah.
No, I don't kick and scream necessarily.
God, we're the opposite. I'm bawling, kicking, screaming, shitting, pissing, all of it.
There's good footage of Matt Myrna being dragged outside the U.S. consulate.
I'd love to see
on
them.
His toes.
What pair of funny pants was he wearing?
Well, he had shorts and sandals. He probably had a cape or something.
I hope he's wearing a cape. That'd be the. I love when cops arrest guys with capes.
We've done hundreds of protests. All the way from the Prime Minister when he was down in Niagara Falls, and Aaron and I went down there and we protested his hotel. It was awesome. It was really awesome because there was a lot of like Secret Service type people all around.
So did you actually see him? Did he walk by you?
His car had to go by us. They were in.
Oh, but you couldn't see his face though.
No, but he was in like a bulletproof type limo. It was the weirdest limo I've ever seen. They call it the Beast. Look it up on Google. It's called the Beast.
The Beast.
He was in a thing called the Beast, and this thing is like we're talking, you know, foot and a half thick inch glass, but whatever. But yeah, I always thought that, you know, this type of stuff, first of all, is fun too. Like the marijuana movement, outside of the fact that, see, also, while all this was happening, I was in political science at McMaster University, and I spent, you know, I have a 3.5 year undergraduate degree. I spent like 2.5 years there.
So when you got into university,
yeah,
you'd already done some activism and some protests with weed.
That's right.
So they didn't look at that when they accepted you into McMaster?
They did.
Did they?
Like, yeah.
They looked like, you got great grades and everything, but Jesus, buddy. You're all over the news.
Well, see, at the time I was only, I wasn't necessarily all over the news yet. It was a once a year thing. 420 only happened once a year. And it started getting better after the fourth year. And by then, people started saying things like, you can't do this every day, which is why I decided, let's do this every day. Like, what do you mean we can't do this every day? So
this is just your personality, really. As soon as you're told no, you say yes, regardless of what it is.
Well, yeah.
If you feel, you're like, no, I'll do it anyway, fuck you.
See, yeah, I also believe sometimes no was important. No, like, no, because it'll harm you or harm other people was an important thing to learn.
Right.
But no with no justification or the one you're giving is wrong after I've looked into it or, it's part of my personality that I just could not handle that.
All right, so you start up in smoke.
So, yeah. And
now,
then,
did you have a partner for that? Was there a backer?
I played it in that clip. Ryan Clark, me and a guy named Ryan. He was working at a place called Spiritual Smoke, a block and a half away from where Up in Smoke opened, and he was just a kid working at a head shop that said it's all for tobacco. And me and him talked it over and said, let's do this thing that's revolutionary.
But that kind of thing also, pisses you off, right? When people hide behind.
Like Mark Emery was the only one that didn't. His paper packs at the time said that these are for marijuana use only. So I started following that same, like, hardcore philosophy.
Right.
I put up a big sign on my windows that said all of our products are to be used exclusively for the use of marijuana,
right,
whether it's illegal or not. And that meant that if you bought a lighter at Up and Smoke Cafe, you were buying a lighter to intentionally use it to light marijuana,
right,
which made the sale of the lighter illegal in the criminal code.
Right.
Because the criminal code right now says paraphernalia is anything with the intention that it's to be used for an illegal act.
Right. Because your philosophy is, why protest if you're just going to hide and pretend you're not?
That's right.
Anyway.
It's hypocritical, right, of course.
So you guys start Up and Smoke, and it's a huge success.
It is.
Millions of customers.
Well, a week into opening it, they arrest 76-year-old Gene Cooper, even though we had, yes, a huge grand opening and a huge week. 7 days go by, and literally on the eighth day, they arrested her. And it created a situation where the cops didn't know what to do with us now. She had a stroke during the arrest.
Yeah, I saw the video of that. That's fucking crazy.
And it was shocking to us because she was a
And you were standing right
woman.
There.
I wasn't right there. Oh, I was actually in a business meeting in Toronto at the time, and I got a phone call that it was happening, and I drove right back. 45 minutes there, and it was already almost finished. Obviously, I did some interviews and stuff, but... And then she was in court a week later.
Now, they try to spin that so it looked like the weed caused the stroke?
No, nothing like that. If anything, the news gave us the benefit of the doubt. On CH News and everything else was, you know, maybe they weren't doing anything that bad. Maybe it was just a bunch of people playing chess and, you know... Like old people consuming medicine and young people doing whatever.
How do you do anything to an old person? They're a fucking old person.
And that's kind of what the city started saying about
it. It's so
me.
Ridiculous. Like they're
so it gave us about 6 to 8 months of nothing. They
just avoided you altogether.
They avoided me from altogether. So that was the strangest thing I've ever seen because there was 15 cops on my grand opening. We had a lineup of we had 350 people. In and out of my store on the day we opened for business. And you know, things as they were, you know, they slowed down and picked back up and this and that. And then that arrest and more controversy. And then no cop visits, not one, for 8 months.
Do you think any cops come in here to get high just after the job? You don't know they're cops, or maybe you do?
Well, at the end of all of Up and Smoke Saga, I was sentenced to 6 months in jail. And then... A week after getting out, I'm already in this building looking at a pile of junk and saying, let's do another one. And I had 2 more years probation. I still had a fine I had to pay off. I had a whole bunch of
stuff. So what changed from there to here?
Nothing's ever changed. The mantra's still the same.
The mantra's the same, but what did you do differently when you started running this place?
I don't think I've ever done anything differently. I think it's just slowly you get more skilled, you know, at tactics. It's all just tactics. The philosophy's always been the same, though.
Was it maybe because in Hamilton, because it's a smaller city, a smaller community, that it just seemed
different.
More important, or it seemed like a big news story there, where in Toronto it would kind of fall by the wayside, no one really noticed?
See, that was in my business plan, absolutely. That Hamilton, the idea was that, first of all, Hamilton didn't allow anything in the realm of activism, or, you know, Toronto and a lot of other big cities are famous for Pride and
right.
You know, Anonymous or Occupy or whatever. Hamilton had no part of any of that, right? And to me, it was a thing that I just couldn't accept. And yeah, so we were trying to, and we did a very good job, as you saw some clips of. We were all over, like it was huge news. And Toronto, that's not the case. Like there was no objective or even desire of mine to like break that purview of Toronto media.
Right.
And although we've gotten into it, we've been on the front page of the Toronto Sun before, we've been on CB24 and CTV and Global and this and that, and it's been clips here, clips there. And
I love
good.
When the news talks about weed because they don't know how to say it. It's not in their vocabulary. So we went down where they were smoking marijuana. Like, it's all fucking jumbled.
Well, to them, it's spelled with an H or a J. They're not sure the criminal code.
They rolled up their pot cigarettes. This fucking makes me laugh.
Yeah.
Jesus
but to
Christ.
Me, I always thought even if we could afford to put full-page ads or 30-second commercials expressing our point of view and saying we want the drug war to end, that, it, you know, it's million. You know how much it costs for a full-page ad in, like, Toronto Sun on a whatever?
It's
or
like a
Global
billion.
Mail?
It's $1 billion.
Well, it's $10,000,
yeah,
$15,000, $25,000, $35,000, stuff like that, just for one day. You know, and to me, that's what it was. To
and that's fucked up because no one reads the newspaper anymore.
I know. Well, they're becoming dinosaur media.
Yeah.
And other things are taking over.
This is off topic, but how do you feel about Twitter essentially being the new news?
Well,
that's what people look to now first to get updates.
I don't know. I do a lot of searches on Twitter, and first 8 come up: CTV, Global, and Bloomberg, and Drudge Report, and Huffington Post, and RT, and this, that, and the other. Some of them are a little underground and a little bit more. I don't know. They're not necessarily the top 5 news broadcasters like Russia Today and a bunch of others that are. getting world importance for
when you see
the
big names, you know, like all the different news cut. Do you
yeah,
just
you see CNN,
do you just, do you see lies all the time? You're like, ah, lies, lies, scroll up, scroll.
Sure, yeah.
Bullshit, bullshit, bullshit.
Yeah.
All right, so you start, you walk out of prison, a week later you're here looking at boxes.
Yeah.
What did you want originally? Because we have this great place now. It's fantastic. There's a bar, entertainment, television.
See, I watched this movie about Pierre Trudeau, actually, and he says it in it, and they use a couple of examples of striving that, for more than you want. I guess that there's a quote from
that
Bruce
goddamn
Lee,
hippie liberal.
Bruce Lee about punching further than you want. One of the comics does a joke about it. I think
the one-inch punch.
The one-inch punch.
It's a huge punch.
What if I strive for anal then? Is his joke, I think, is the punchline. You know, I don't know.
All right, yeah. So, I know what you're talking about.
So with the same idealism, when Up in Smoke started, a week before our opening, the police called me in with my landlord. My landlord calls me up and says, listen, I'm being subpoenaed. I have to go in, and you're coming with me. And this and that. I know you'd probably whatever. But, so I went down, and during this meeting, a Hamilton Spectator reporter's there and everything. It's weird. They had lawyers there telling me, if you openly smoke cannabis, the first thing we're doing is charging you under the Ontario Smoke-Free Act. And I had a lawyer there arguing they couldn't, and their lawyer backed down.
How old are you at this time?
I was 22.
22 and you have your own fucking lawyer.
Well, I had
to. I don't
have
a lawyer now.
Yeah.
Nor do I ever think I will.
That, I had my own house when I was 18.
You fuck. How do you do that?
Yeah, it was easy.
That's awesome.
It was awesome.
Did you say it was easy?
It was easy.
It's not easy.
It is.
It's not.
There are everything.
You're so much more, you're well put together.
A lot of people ask me about how to open up your own business, and literally there are models that you could open up. You could do every part of the business for free without investing $1. There is an answer to every single. How do you lease the building? How do you
see,
get
why
stock?
Is your face not on the front of the weed culture?
Wow.
Because you're so well put together. You're a clean cut guy. You got a family. You're married. There's
I do
all
have
this love.
I have two kids.
You have two kids, which you
I'm
had
married.
During all of this shit.
Yeah.
We'll get into that right after this. But you have all this, and that's you're not what people think of when they think of your average pothead. When people think of a guy who smokes
think.
Pot, they think of like, dude, man. Yeah, weed. Like, that's what people think about. They think about bell bottoms and fucking twirly shirts. It's ridiculous.
Sure.
So does that bother you that gets displayed as the primary image of weed?
Not really.
No, you don't give a fuck?
No.
You don't think it harms the movement?
Not really.
You don't think it harms the Green Party when they are trying to run for government?
You're putting too much credibility in, like, every one of their arguments. Just because the actor for the media or the actor for the politicians or whatever comes out and says these things, and even if they become social mantras in a way, I don't think we're all that stupid to believe it. I think we're not all that gullible. I think most of us are suspicious in nature.
I don't think most people here are that gullible or that stupid, but you have a mainstream of people that absolutely think that way. People out in Saskatchewan.
No, I don't think so. I think if you sat down with most people, even people that are ignorant for some generalizations on the term, as soon as you go past one, you know, question, one answer type knowledge and start having a conversation with a person, I don't think that they would say, I really believe all stoners are Cheech and Chong, like, or no, they would probably say some are, and they would probably be that way if they did acid or other things too, and if it, or not. Or, you know, they're, maybe that's the... Most people would probably have a realistic worldview. I don't think people are that gullible into thinking everyone fits this just box definition of...
Right.
I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong, but I have higher hopes for...
But yeah, you get to... You live in it, though. This is... You see all types come through this place.
Well, see, that's the other thing about this world, and at least, especially my experience running these pod cafes and rallies the way I've done, like... most people, if you ran any other business, that's it. You're going to get your market, right?
Right.
You know, you run a rock bar, you're getting the 30-year-olds that like that kind of music you play and whatever else, right? You know, you run anything else. If you're in any other political scene, you're only getting the left or the right or the greens, and that's all you really get, you know? But the marijuana movement happens to be everything. You know, marijuana smokers are both atheists and Christians.
You know, that's what I love about weed, because it brings everyone together.
No, regardless, you can fight over anything, but if you're sharing a joint.
But most other things don't. Like the.
No, well, booze separates people completely.
Booze?
Booze, for sure. What a horrific... I love it, but it's made to hurt.
Maybe.
Like, people, if two people drink it, it can turn into a fight so fast.
Most of the scenes I've seen of people... Yeah, I don't know.
I've never seen a weed fight. I don't know what that looks like.
Yeah, there's...
I bet it's fucking hysterical.
Sure.
And incredibly slow.
Man, I'm gonna fuck you, what?
I don't know, you've probably seen a weed fight. You ever see two guys go at it, just high as shit?
I've fought a few times in my
Not
life.
Not cops, I mean each other.
No, I've never fought another person because I'm high on weed or anything. Weed, yeah, generally is more passive and stuff, and generally, even with hundreds of people in vapor lounges and stuff like this, most people don't even get past arguing. It never really becomes passionate in that way, physically
right.
passionate. But that's not to say that it couldn't, and it hasn't. I'm sure, obviously it has.
All right, I want to fight you. We're going to do that now. I'm going to get you riled up so we fight. Yeah.
I drank young in my life, too. So when I was drinking alcohol when I was like 14, 15, I actually went to AA when I was like 15. And then I started smoking weed around the hash experience I had.
It does seem very much that if you smoke weed, you probably don't drink. But not the other way around. If you drink, you can just do just as much anyway.
I guess.
But I know for me, if I smoke pot, I can't drink.
I also joined the wrestling team after I started smoking weed. And I don't know. Fights just became... You started thinking of that you put yourself in the situation and escalate, you know, a situation to the point at which it becomes violent.
Right.
Or that your passions outweigh your logic and your common sense.
All right, so how old are you? You got two kids.
I do have two
kids. They smoke weed?
No, my son is 8 and my daughter is 4.
That's the perfect age to train them to smoke
weed.
Well,
they know all about, you know, weed. My son's
Is there a part
clones.
Of you, like, when they were, like, little babies, did you just blow smoke in their face? Like, just
no, I would
like,
never blow smoke in a baby's face, huh?
I don't believe you. I totally
You don't
do
believe
it.
Me.
I believe. Of course I believe you.
Listen,
first
of all...
Of course I believe you. You're a responsible human being with a house.
I could have also... I could have also played a couple clips of me, which is that, I don't know. I was young and in high school in Hill Park. This motherfucker might know. But the high school sweethearts, in a way, the woman I married, we were together since grade 10. We got married, bought a house right away when we got out of high school. I went to Mohawk College, and she went to McMaster University, and then I eventually went to Mac, too. And then these smokeouts and stuff like that were a part of my life, and I was following the Vancouver scene a little bit. And
so how old were you when you had your first kid?
It wasn't until I was originally married for 5 years until my son was born.
So you were 23.
I was 23. And then I opened the Oven Smoke Cafe.
So how did you feel having a child, knowing that opening a business like this could get you arrested? Like, how did you balance that in your brain? Like the
To me, the you just separate, first of all, the fact that you can... There's things you do as a job, and there
right.
are things you do in your personal life, and they're separate.
But you had
and
no fear
it.
Of, like, people thinking you'd be a bad father if you opened this place and
I
got arrested on purpose?
I had, first of all, no fear of it. I anticipated that they'd say it. I either had defenses to it or could care less if they made inaccurate claims other than
right.
to maybe correct them. But other than that, no, it didn't bother me.
Do you think your kids are going to remember any of this stuff?
Well,
at the time, when they get older, like, hey, Dad, we remember you jumping in and out of jail.
So we're at a rally, probably like the 50th rally I'd ever done in my life. And a year after Up in Smoke opened, so we're having our year anniversary rally, right? It's the biggest thing I've ever done. Forget 420s when I just had a part-time job. This is, I had a business, it's open for a year. There's thousands of people there.
You're rolling around
in
a bed of money.
There's money
doing coke off
in.
Every table, just mounds of coke.
Yeah.
Whores all over
First
the place.
I've never done coke or anything like that. That's insane. But regardless, yes, it was like that. It was.
I love that you have to backtrack on all my jokes. Just like, no, I didn't do that. No.
No, no, no.
No, no, no.
As if people are believing the Cal Coke reference.
I'm full of shit 98% of the time. It's wonderful.
But a cop says to me at that rally, while I'm smoking weed talking to him, trying to explain, as I do, that look at these thousands of people. There's like 1,500 people at the time or something standing right there as we're speaking with this cop. And then I'm saying to him things like, my aunt is a teacher at a local high school, and she smokes weed every day, and she was open about it. And my wife is a registered nurse. Forget going to Mohawk College or anything. She's actually an RN in the surgical trauma unit at the General Hospital in Hamilton. And I, although I didn't finish political science, I was a political science student and doing very well, and this is my business, and I now have 5 employees, and I'm young, and I'm, yeah, and I just had a child, and me and my wife smoke weed every day. This is basically,
you're on top of the world.
I'm top of the world, and we're doing well, and we're responsible, and we pay our taxes, and except for the fact that there's a prohibition, what is wrong with this picture? Like, you're not arguing for back alleys, you're not saying, like, I don't see that. That's not my purview, right?
Right.
And at least that's not the one I'm advocating. So the harm associated with abuse, for instance, right? I would always argue against that. I would always say that if the economics don't work, you shouldn't, you know, spend 50% of your income on, you know, the thing that you enjoy, right?
Right.
You know, you have
which
other obligations.
Which the government sells cigarettes knowing that it is actively addictive.
Sure. So there are things that could be abusive and harmful to your life, and I would argue against those things. And I don't care what they are, right? It makes no difference to me.
But having children
so this this argument, I know I rant, but that conversation in itself was so important to me because that is what he walked away from that conversation, that 20 minutes I talked with him, and filed an official police complaint under the Police Services Act, saying that that conversation led him to believe that my child was possibly under abuse or living under abuse or neglect.
Oh, it's because you're blowing smoke in the baby's face.
Because I was blowing smoke. So that started.
He doesn't do that. He doesn't do that.
A 3.5 month Canadian children child, you know, services report against me.
So they're coming to your door. You got to see your kid through glass.
3 days later, I get a phone call while I'm, you know, going to work. Going to the store early in the morning. It's 9:30 a.m. Place opens at 11. I get there at 10, and I got a call. I had left 10 minutes before, so I'm just on the road.
Right.
And it's my wife saying a police car and the Children's Aid Society is here.
Do they grab the kids?
I say lock the door. Do not reply. Do not speak to them. Fucking, you know.
You just did a U-turn.
Locked
went
the
right
window and U-turned it. Yeah, U-turned it. Went right back on my way. Friggin' called the media.
Were you ravenous? Were you fucking pissed?
I was enraged, yeah.
Playing Mama Bear. You come after my cubs.
You come after
I'll
my kids.
I'll fucking kill you!
There was a bit of that in me. Well, first of all, it wasn't I will kill you. It was more, if you try and take this my son out of my wife's arms or out of my arms, you know.
Right.
If you try to do either one of those things, I will kill you.
Yeah, I'm such a pussy. I would have just given them my kid. Here, take him. Take it. Just take it. Fuck it. I shit myself again.
I actually had those feelings, though. I did. I was so enraged, yes. But I started doing open interviews. I started allowing the media in.
Right.
And that was it.
Like into your home.
Tour my home. Feel free to look at everything from top to bottom. They wrote reports. I did hour-long interviews. But every single thing I did was against the will of my wife.
Right. Oh, is that what caused some tension?
The moment that phone call happened was the moment she said, this cannot cross. You said it would be separate.
Right. Oh, she caught you in a lie.
No, there was no lie. There was just, what is your choice? Where am I going to go? I was under a predicament. What are you going to do? Are you going to, you know?
I like that idea. Come into my home. Check out my cool shit.
Well,
I got an old record player from the 70s. It's awesome.
There was that kind of thing. It was just normalcy, right? It was to prove that we were just normal. That you know, we were on the front page of the newspaper the next day and everything else. And it was tough because I had people around me, my parents, but other friends and mentors saying, you know, I know Goodwin. I know you're the hash mob, and I know you do all these things, but this is your kid. And suck it up, swallow your pride, just lie. And I actually had the people telling me to lie, too. So the next investigation by Children's Aid Society went something to the effect of, out of everything else, 99% of everything else they did, normally do, and do, was, you know, just, you know, as long as you say, you know, that you don't smoke weed around your kid, you're not blowing in the baby's face, basically.
Right.
Just say you don't, and this is over. And first of all, I didn't say I did or didn't. Like, it wasn't a matter of that. First of all, I don't blow it in the baby's face. But just say you're not high around. Just say you don't use around. It was all a generalization. It kept going like that to the point
of... Very broad terms they're using.
Yeah, yeah. They weren't being as in your face as, you know, blowing in a... That would be, you know, like blowing in a cat's face or a dog's face. It's abusive regardless if it's an animal or a child, but...
I've gotten a few dogs high.
Yeah, most people...
That shit's funny.
I guess so.
I don't know what the dog's going through.
I've never done that. Awesome. I've actually been against the whole idea behind tricking anybody into, you know, the whole... I guess there was the... Yeah, good. Clap. Because
I do agree with that now, but when I was a child and an idiot,
I actually
an
have
asshole.
Enough morals in regard... I used to sell salvia at Up and Smoke, too, because I sold everything. It was Toronto Hemp Company, Vapor Central, Sacred Seed, Kinder Cafe, all logged into one. But whenever I got the impression that anybody I sold salvia to would do anything like... After 10 bong hits with friends, the 11th one was salvia, and it was to trick him into taking a toke that would make him trip out, and then they would all laugh at them. Ah, that would be it. They would be
gone.
Not for either gone, or I would, use my power I have to just say you're not buying my product.
I will say it's very impressive that, you know, you go to any bar in the city, the bouncers are huge beast motherfuckers ready to crack your head at any given moment. But this is a place where it's so friendly and peaceful, you've never needed anyone like that here. It doesn't seem.
Well.
Once or twice? Come up and join us, buddy.
Mookie's up in the corner.
All right. It'd be fun. Okay. I didn't catch your name. Mookie?
It's Mookie Wilson.
Well, if you want to come up, Wilson, come on up.
What time are we at?
Oh, gee, I haven't even checked. We've been going on a rant here. It's been good. 10 o'clock.
Yeah,
Jesus,
we'll
that's gone by
too.
So fast.
But yeah, so in answer to that, I was in freestyle wrestling for 8 years on the wrestling team and stuff. I got in a lot of fights when I was younger before I started smoking weed. And, like, I can handle my own, but I don't know. I've never needed it. Yeah, it's even drunks have come up here. So you would think a group of four or five guys, and one or two of them are drunk, one of them's really aggressive, that it would take something like bouncers to handle that. Because that's like any bar, regardless of everything else that's peaceful in the podcast. These people are being just as violent as the most, you know, violent scenarios in any bar. And yeah, it's just me and Maddie and Sean and a couple other people, some of our regulars.
I don't think any of you stand over 5'3".
Aww.
You're all puny dudes.
I'm not 5'3", but I'm short.
Oliver's got a broken arm. He's fucking useless now.
I said I was 5'8" to somebody on the phone the other day, and Aaron went 5'8". I said, okay, I'm like 5'7½", but what the fuck?
How many greenouts do you get here on average?
Oh, God. Greenouts are
everywhere. What is a green? Tell me exactly what a greenout is. Do you know if you know chemically or how that works?
I don't know.
I've done it, but I don't actually know.
In my research, I would assume it's blood sugar content, and it exactly is blood sugar content. And then Mookie's right yelling it out. And
so it's low or high? It's low blood sugar. Right, okay, I get you. If you just...
He said it's like running a marathon and then just passing out or something. And yeah, it has similar associations to that, I guess.
So can we pretend we're all athletes now?
Your blood sugar content and how... or yes, blood pressure, blood sugar.
All right, so I remember when you started Vapor Central. How long was it before the comedy moved in? It was pretty quick,
wasn't
it?
So that was February 2007. And Up in Smoke, as soon as we opened... Joey, Puff Mama, Joanne Baker, whatever. Go to puffmama.ca if everyone wants to check out another the coolest lady in the world.
She runs the underground comedy, which is under Clandestine House.
Yes.
It used to be Clandestine, now it's Clandestine House. Yes. Really cool little place. Check it out.
So she started bringing comics from Toronto to Hamilton. She heard about what I was doing, opening the Up in Smoke, and thought it was the coolest thing in the world. We started selling Puff Mama baked goods there, and it was the greatest thing in the world. And the comedy shows started becoming very popular, to the point where at Up in Smoke, even if we were like this, you know, there's, you know, 50 people, 100 people, 150, any given, comedy shows were like the busiest. You know, the most amount of people we had in the building that week or that month.
Fucking great.
And it's because it was great. It was. It was really one of I think the highlights of our success and evolution. It actually, you know,
well, it makes it more than just a place. It is a place to smoke weed.
Well, it
but you offer so much more.
And when you say more, it almost adds a complete another level. It's like, you know, building houses all around, and yeah, vapor lounges open up. But adding comedy shows to them is like two floor houses. It's like a whole nother level.
Right.
It really did bring us double as far as we naturally would have without their, you know, inclusion. And so I think these comedy shows were, you know, deserve a lot of the support.
Well, you are one of few people in the city that treats comics incredibly well.
Well, I do personally. Not to, I don't know, single anybody out or anything.
Well, single people out. Let's do it.
Sure, go ahead if you want. I don't know.
Oh, I mean other producers. No, fuck no. You treat everyone great here. Okay, let's jump into this. We only got 20 minutes left anyway.
So naturally the comedy shows moved to Vapor Central after Up and Smoke and Hamilton closed, and I moved everything here and we opened up. And Brian O'Gorman started Weedy Wednesday in a month after we opened, in like March of 2007. April 2007, we had another April 20th grand opening, a bigger comedy show. We started doing them every week again, and on it's gone. We're upwards of 330 or something Weedy Wednesdays.
All right, so this is a conversation we've had before, and I like it. I do. You're a huge success. Prohibition still exists. What happens when weed's legal? What happens with everything that you built?
It all depends on what you mean by legal, because I'm not necessarily a fan of legalization. So,
well, this is what I want to get into. The government goes, all right.
Someone from the audience was asking how you think Washington and Colorado is going to affect
Canada.
How's
the chat going, too? I haven't looked at it in 10 years.
I haven't looked into how Washington and Colorado are doing. I know... No, I'm fine.
I guess Chris is inside.
Thanks,
on
though.
That.
Yeah, how's Washington doing with their new...
Well, I don't know. Psychologically, it helped, right? It gives everybody the perception that things are changing. If two U.S. states can do it within the boundaries of... it changes on so many levels. The U.N., for instance, other countries already are saying things like, you know, like a country like Spain or something, or Portugal, or want to go a different direction with their national drug laws. They want to take their own direction. They have their own ideas.
Right.
I know they have, and other countries have too, and other countries around them want to. So here's where this comes up, right? Where they decide to take it further than the places like even Spain, Portugal, Greece, whatever. And they want to go one step further than that, and they're told at the UN level, wait a minute, we've all signed this UN anti-contravention on drugs that the U.S. enforces, and the U.S. says they'll embargo you. They'll stop trade. They'll whatever. And that's what they always have said. But they ramp up those type of international arguments over the last 20 years, and they've gotten good at making them, the U.S. has. So now it's threatening, right? It's the carrot and the stick. They offer you incentive to go their way and hit you with a stick if you don't, and most countries comply. And now they don't have to comply. They can look and say, wait a minute, you're not following your own treaty. You have two U.S. states internally that are violating the U.N. contravention. So why can't we violate it nationally? If you can have two of your states violate it, we can have our country violate it.
I love the government. They sound like a bunch of children. Well, you did it, so I want to do it. Why can't we do it if you're doing it?
That's all what government is today.
It's fucking bullshit.
It's corrupt trading of influence, and I'm not for any of that.
All right, so anyway, my point was it's legal now. Let's pretend it's legal now. The government sells it. They tax it. All these shops where you can smoke it.
You said something to me about the fact that why don't we... It would be cool if we could use tax money to fund healthcare and stuff. And I started to say... Tried to make fun of you by saying, like, it's just ridiculous that when we legal... Like, when we repeal something that's unjust, or we legalize from currently prohibition, or however you want to put that changeover, that we're going to now go to a system of regulation and taxation so severe as to fund, like... Something as entirely as healthcare or something.
But that's what's going to happen with it. That's what they do with everything. That's what they do with smokes. That's what they do with booze. Like, all that shit's taxed very heavily for that reason.
Well, first of all, cigarettes, nicotine, and tobacco, I don't think were ever prohibited. Alcohol obviously was at certain points, but only for a very short amount of time. And they cost healthcare billions. But...
Booze, yes. Smokes, I don't think nearly as much. I know the stats out there are crazy. Nah, I can't agree with that. I can't agree that booze...
Anyways, I'm not a fan of smokes anymore. In any way. I could care less if they do cause a harm. Syntaxing all these products is not necessarily the appropriate way to do it.
It is something we've already established, though, so why would they treat weed any different?
Well, they're not going to. That's right. What everybody in our industry growing up, the whole fuck the government idealism, has all, in some ways rested on partially the fact that, hey, this is still an ungovernment-touched commodity. It's one that when I sell a pound, it's my $3,500.
Right.
You know, the government didn't get their 13% HST. They didn't get their income tax. And fuck them. So, and I still believe in that. Fuck the government. They don't deserve it. They're the injustice. They're the one that are only going to use that money for to harm more people. And yeah, they might remove drug prohibition, but they're just going to harm more people in worse ways. Probably with overregulation.
I also wonder, too, with weed, if you legalize it and you do tax it and the government sells it, it doesn't stop people from still growing their own. Because unlike smokes, where it has to be, you know, what you have to do to it to make it smokable, the tobacco leaf, you have to do so much to it to make it even fucking tolerable. Booze is hard to make. Like, you can do it on your own, but it's a larger process. Where weed's fairly simple to grow.
Fairly.
So what's stopping people from... How are you getting rid of that by legalizing it? I don't think you are, because people still grow it themselves and not have to pay shit for it.
Well, the RCMP has said for the last 20 years that, and I bet you it's one of the reasons it stops it completely is their recommendation to the Prime Minister would be something to the effect of, the day we repeal prohibition or legalize, tax, regulate, license, sell, distribute, anything you do or let them have it on their own, you will never be able to overwhelm the already current distribution method. It's a basic sentence. You will never be able to overwhelm the already occurring distribution methods, ever.
Right.
There's nothing they'll be able
to
do.
So how it's done now is so big, you couldn't possibly deter people.
You couldn't possibly deter people, that's right. You couldn't ever.
So you have a bunch of 14-year-old kids trying to buy weed at the store. They'd be the only people who'd go.
Mookie's saying something about crappy weed or something, too. I don't know. Maybe they would do better at offering higher end. I don't know.
So what happens to this place?
The Vapor Lounge model was never necessarily meant to exist in a legalized world. So
well, that's what I'm talking about. What happens to it? You shut it down? You put the chains on the doors?
In the Amsterdam model or the bar, cafe, club model would have to be more suitable. The fact that we're doing some live shows is helpful. Nobody's going to pay $5 at 1 p.m. to smoke weed when marijuana is legal. It doesn't make any sense.
Right.
They might come in for free, like cafes that allow anybody to walk in for free.
But is this something that you would want, that you'd still exist in, or would you go to look for another fight? Would you like, where else is our freedom being exploited and pulled back? Where can I go now? Because it's embedded in you. You're an activist. I can see that in you.
Sure, I may. If the injustice... See, it was always to me early on, you asked me why when I was like 14, 15. Well, I started seeing people getting arrested for weed. Like, friends of mine were smoking weed in the park and cops would roll up. And it was always like, wait a minute, nobody here is fighting or anything. We're all just smoking joints, right? We're all just, like, I don't know. It always boggled my mind that such a peaceful act required such a violent response.
Right.
And so that was the injustice to me. That was always how I saw it. And if the same comparison can be made to any other scenario... If they're using such a violent response to such a peaceful means, I think I'd be there as an advocate to stop it.
Right.
If it doesn't exist, I hope it doesn't. I'd rather it doesn't. I'd rather go spend the weekend at the cottage than have people out there violently responding to peaceful people.
All right, we got to wrap it up soon. How about you give advice to new people who want to take part in the drug war? Let's recruit some goddamn soldiers.
Well, first...
you got one going. All right.
Normally what I say, I actually hinted towards it while I was talking about it, which is that a lot of people say, I've had enough, I can't take it, and I'm done. And if you think that getting kicked to the ground, knee to the back of the head, cuffs on too tight is too much for somebody like you, if going to court 5-10 times, if probation and whatever and possible convictions are too much, then activism is not for you. If those type of things, because you're also a thug, or you're also a whatever, you also believe you're an anarchist, you also believe other things that, and the world is just too fucked up where you don't care anymore, that these things are less.
See, I am all those things. I'm an activist and I'm all these things, but I feel like that at home where I'm safe.
You feel like what?
Like, I feel very, like, when I'm home, I'm like, I can see all the atrocities. I'm like, I don't agree with this, I don't agree with this, and that's fucking bullshit. And, but I'm at home where
no,
I'm
listen,
safe.
No, listen, I think we all
but
have
doing
a
it
job,
outside of the house.
First of all, if you have any mental awareness to what some of the things I'm saying in regards to any disenfranchised class, and you can do something about it, you could even be one of their accountants, be one of their lawyers, be one of their teachers, be one of their healthcare providers. And you don't have to be one of their activist friends, right? Everybody has a job to play in advancing freedom and helping this world get to a better place. But what you're asking me was about advice for activists and recruiting activists would be that if first of all, I've never minded being arrested. It's never bothered me on an emotional
scale. Well, you say that
scale.
To the people you hire here too, right? Well, that's part of the interview process, right?
It are is
you
part of the
are you comfortable being arrested?
Come sit down, Mookie, for the last 5 minutes of this.
It's 4:20 a.m. in Amsterdam, everyone.
Oh. Woo!
We're nearing the end of the CK podcast, so thanks, everyone, for tuning in tonight. Follow @CalPost to get great comedy on Twitter.
Aaron's actually been through a lot of the interviews, too, so she's heard what I say to all the employees.
Yeah, you can follow Chris at 420 Toronto on Twitter.
I'm at 420 Toronto on
Twitter. Are you shutting us down, Aaron?
Just sitting down there is @MookTheGreek on Twitter.
Very accurate.
No, you guys can shut it down.
I guess the point is being an activist takes a hell of a lot of fucking risks. And to me, though, those risks aren't sacrifices because they're to my advantage. And if you also think it's to your advantage and that it's only par for the course or it's only the cost of doing business, is like in 12 years I've spent 11 and a half months in jail, but we've also generated, and conservatively so, I've generated $10 million in sales.
I can't believe
this. And that kind of money has allowed us to do some pretty big events over the years. And
that's a stimulus package for Toronto and Young Street in general.
Yeah, but that's a shitty place for that money to go, is to save wealth to people.
That's a significant portion of what the provincial government just cut from Toronto.
One of these mics is backbeating, but... Well, no, that's just sales overall. That's not... I've never had $10 million in my life, and
I have.
Every sale I've ever
what
done...
What a terrible weekend in Vegas.
...might include that much, but...
Let's call it a night, guys. This was a fantastic show. I really enjoyed this. It was something new and different. No, I'm right, buddy.
Where do you think this is all going before we end?
Where do I think this is going? I think, like everything else, it's going to get eventually franchised and made not cool. Because that's what happens to things that become extremely popular. Doesn't mean anyone will stop doing it.
You think it'll become more cool?
No, it won't become more cool. It'll definitely lose some edge to what it is, especially, you know, to... I know when I started, that was one of the reasons. That's why you do anything when you're a fucking child. Like, oh, I want to look awesome. I started smoking cigarettes. Why I drank young.
Oh, you lost it.
That's why I started smoking pot. Like, that kind of thing. So I think as soon as it's legalized, it's going to get franchised out. Pepsi's going to start selling it. Coca-Cola will get a fucking version of it. It's like, it's not Pepsi, but it doesn't taste the same. It'll be people smoking joints with cups over top. It'll be fucked up and stupid. So then people will have to find something new to rebel with. Now, will they go higher? Will they go to mushrooms? Will they go to coke? What is the next thing?
A lot of people are talking, and I've been hearing on almost every podcast that I respect, a lot of people are talking about DMT and various other psychoactive things like that, that they go out to the Amazon with shamans and have these psychedelic experiences.
There's hundreds of the ethnobotanicals that not only aren't publicized, like no one even knows about them, period, so there's tons of places to go. Some of them will be pure crap, but there's like hundreds of thousands of mushroom strains, different funguses that we never messed around with.
Yeah, mushrooms are fucked, man.
Yeah, the DMT for sure is really popular, and even like the dabs and the BHO has only been around since the year 2000.
Right.
So the vast majority of people haven't tried that yet. That will change.
All right, I think negative I got one
and
question.
Positive perception. Yeah, go ahead.
One question, right? And then we're gonna stop. We're gonna go. But I want to ask you guys, what is the most new inventive way you've seen someone smoke pot recently?
Sublimator with the electric nail.
The electric nail. I saw that was fucking awesome.
I'd say that's about
right. Oh, they're gonna start probably booing you on the chat.
I didn't say it was good, and I didn't even try it. I said, "What's the newest thing that I've seen?" That
no,
the oil
mean.
Is from the year 2000. The winterized purifications from a few years ago. That's the same chemical process.
I wonder if
process.
Anyone's ever smoked pot.
I'm hearing, to make I'm an hearing absolute. About, I'm hearing about laser
IR
nails.
Fuck off! I will
IR.
Smoke a lot more weed if there's lasers.
There's a DJ who has a
vaporizing unit developed in, I believe, Vaughan or Burlington.
Where's my joint?
Camp.
Holy fuck.
Oh, they're all
Camp Compton.
I wonder if anyone's ever smoked
Eric
weed
Campton.
Out of an astronaut helmet.
I don't know.
If anyone just got a hold of the astronaut
helmet.
Oh, I
guess the newest way would have been the post that Shaw made about the guy who smoked 35 grams of butter hot box in his room. He's just throwing it on a grill.
Jesus.
That's like the oldest way in the world.
Yeah, but no, I don't think anyone's done it.
Isn't that how cavemen accidentally got high?
I don't think anyone's done it with $3,000.
That's like in the Bible.
That probably was the oldest, because the first experience of burning cannabis was likely as
sage.
Means to keep someone warm.
Yeah.
Right? They threw it in the fire.
You have to see this video.
I don't think that anyone's done $3,000 worth of concentrates by themselves, though. That's the new
Mark,
part.
Mark
we watched it on
Clokied
the Marijuana Show.
Did it.
All right, guys, we're losing course.
What video?
Where Clokey drops an enormous amount of
it's called 35.5 grams.
It's pretty good.
Or something
he
like
drops
this.
It all over the place. It's insane.
Okay, Aaron, I'm going to close off the show and then we'll play the video.
I have one more question. Has anyone ever hotboxed a car by putting their herb or butter in the carburetor, like in the engine block, and throwing the heater on? That's what I want to know. Like, Toronto winter style. Right to the face.
Only cooked a pizza.
No.
All
I'm
right.
So fucking
my man,
right now.
My man is breaking the food truck bylaw
all right,
by
turn
cooking
off
on the
mics,
truck.
Play our song, Cal.
Thank you, Chris, for coming
out.
You're the best producer, and thank
Cal
you for
Post.
Running this wonderful
Cal
place.
Post.
My name is Cal Post. Check out the shows all week here at Vapor Central. We got Third Class Thursdays, Weedy Wednesdays, Stoner Sundays. We got the Marijuana Zone, which is a radio show shot here on Tuesday nights. That's tomorrow night.
7:20 to 10:20.
This has been the CK Podcast. I hope you had a good time. We'll see you again next week where I'll probably talk about my dick a lot. Good night, everybody. Good night.
It's you.
Much more. Should I trade half my money for 10 times as much sex? It's an equation from hell.
Oh, that's
it's an equation from hell.
Oh,
it's an equation from hell.
Oh, that's
it's an equation from hell.
Oh.